Tree, Christmas Eve. You're watching Granada as we join ITN for the news.
Good evening, this is the news from ITN, tonight's headlines. The Prime Minister tells British troops in Bosnia, your safety is my priority. Foreign Office Minister Tristan Garrell-Jones resigns from the government. Another air crash, 157 are killed in Libya. And the ecological disaster unfolding off Spain's Atlantic coast. The Prime Minister paid a surprise visit to Bosnia today to meet and reassure British troops helping the humanitarian aid operation there. Mr. Major predicted the United Nations would pass within days a resolution to enforce a no-fly zone over Bosnia. And he said the safety of the troops on the ground would remain his absolute priority. But his words apparently failed to dispel growing fears among British officers about the effect of a ban on Serbian flights, especially the threat of revenge attacks on UN forces.
It was never going to be just a visit expressing Christmas goodwill. John Major came in by helicopter to the Bosnian border to see a military operation overshadowed by political arguments. The stakes are high, lives are at risk, a decision is looming. Is the British Army to maintain its neutral humanitarian credentials by escorting aid, or will the government adopt increasing anti-Serbian measures that may lead to confrontation on the ground and embroil the army in combat? John Major saw the conditions. He pulled the Christmas crackers. He laughed and joked, but he also recognised there is real anxiety here about whether imposing a no-fly zone would portray the British as having entered the conflict.
When we have that no-fly zone, be absolutely certain that the matter foremost in the minds of the government and others will be to ensure your security out here. That is not for one second going to be overlooked as we make further diplomatic moves.
One military official told me a no-fly zone changes the game entirely. The British would then be seen by the Serbs as legitimate targets. He didn't go near the front line, but John Major saw an army that is far less clear about its mission than it was during its last major deployment in the Gulf. He won't be seeing refugees. He won't be seeing any suffering, and he won't hear any gunfire. But he may leave with a sense of unease over the British Army's exact role here. Later in the day, they cheered him because he bothered to listen. But what he heard may not comfort him. Robert Moore, ITN, Bosnia.
The Foreign Office Minister, Tristan Garrell-Jones, a close friend of the Prime Minister, is resigning from the government. Not, however, until the bill to ratify the Maastricht Treaty is through the Commons. He's strongly pro-Europe. Mr. Garrell-Jones, MP for Watford, said he wanted to spend more time at home. Labour said the resignation was deeply puzzling.
Tristan Garrell-Jones's friends say he and his wife have simply had enough of his 18-hour days, shuttling between Brussels and Westminster. At 51, he says he wants to spend more time at home and on his personal interests. Speaking to ITN from Spain tonight, he added these reasons.
Simply because there's a life beyond politics, which I've always hankered for a bit. This hasn't come as a surprise to any of my friends, but they've known I've wanted this for some time, and I thought now was a good moment.
Mr. Garrell-Jones must also have made the calculation that he's not now going to get either of the two cabinet jobs he really rates, Foreign Secretary or Chancellor. At Westminster, he's known as an arts backroom fixer.
Any other traps involved in all this?
The man at whose Catherine Place home Mrs. Thatcher supported to leave a plot to depose her was hacked. In more recent times, as a Euro enthusiast, he's been much feared by the Euro skeptic. One said tonight, I don't care why he's gone, I'm just delighted he has. Others were more cautious.
Well, I am surprised. He is the Gary Lineker of the Maastricht team, and I doubt very much whether the bill would have got as far as it has done without him organising and arranging things. He's a dedicated European, as happy to see the government of this country taking place from Brussels as from Westminster.
Mr. Garrell-Jones has substantial business interests in Spain. He was also a member of the Lloyd's insurance market. During some of the years, some syndicates incurred heavy losses. John Major will be losing a good friend in Tristan Garrell-Jones, but he must be delighted he's persuaded him to stay on and Maastricht village on the statute book. Sister Gerald Jones knows more about the minutiae of the Maastricht Treaty than anyone else. And with nothing to lose, she's going to prove an even more formidable opponent for the Eurosceptics. Sir Andrews, ITN, Westminster.
The United Nations Special Envoy is to go to Israel to discuss the expulsion of more than 400 Palestinians. Today, the Israeli Supreme Court ruled that the government was not responsible for their flight. The deportees are currently stranded in no man's land between Israel and Lebanon after the Lebanese government also refused to accept them. The Israeli Prime Minister Yitzhak Rabin has confirmed he personally ordered troops to fire warning shots to prevent the men returning to Israel. 157 passengers and crew were killed when a Libyan airliner crashed on an internal flight, the second major air disaster in 2 days. Libyan officials are investigating the cause, but ITN understands the plane collided with a military jet. The Boeing 727 was on a flight from Benghazi to Tripoli this morning, and it came down on its approach to the capital. Ian Glover-James in London reports.
The wreckage was scattered across the desert. Only the wheels and wing section were recognizable. The passengers and crew didn't stand a chance. The airliner plowed into open desert near the capital, Tripoli, disintegrated and burst into flames. Nothing was left. Rescue workers didn't have to hurry. All 157 on board were dead. Libyan Arab Airlines share Tripoli Airport with the Air Force. Experts believe today's crash was a mid-air collision involving a Libyan MiG-23 fighter.
Man crew of the MiG-23 did eject, I understand, but the Libyan crew had no chance at all. Both were very experienced pilots, amongst the most experienced in Libyan Arab Airlines, I understand. They nevertheless had no chance to take any sort of reversal.
Tonight, the Libyans are sifting through the wreckage looking for clues. They're denying the airliner hit a military jet, but are releasing few details of the crash. Foreigners may have been among the passengers. 3,500 Britons live in Libya, and tonight the Foreign Office are checking if any were on board the flight.
Another rush hour bomb exploded in London today. It went off at Hampstead Underground Station just before 5 o'clock. A coded telephone warning had been given. No one was hurt, but some people were still in the station when the bomb exploded. Although no one has said they planted the bomb, it's assumed it's the work of the IRA. Two boys died today in a frozen pond in Chesterfield in Derbyshire. One fell in, the other tried to save him, but also went under the ice before firemen could reach him.
The sheet of ice appeared sturdy enough, but it was in fact far too thin to support any weight. When one teenager fell through, his friends tried in vain to rescue him. Both were dragged under and drowned. Four firemen tried to reach the boys, but were beaten by the freezing conditions. They were taken to hospital in Chesterfield for treatment for hypothermia.
One of them fell in and found the dead, and then he was like, he sank. So the other one, he jumped in after him, and then he started screaming, and then he just sank.
The bodies of the two, one aged 12 and one 13, were recovered 2 hours after they'd fallen into the water. It was still when they still were weighed out for him, and the ice was still thick. To be able to break it as you swam, and it was too thin to support human weight. Park rangers say that all frozen ponds are potential death traps. They want parents to warn children about the dangers of ice, dangers which have bereaved two Chesterfield families just before Christmas.
The government said today that mining won't restart as the 10 pits threatened with early closure, despite yesterday's High Court ruling. Miners' lawyers warned the president of the Board of Trade, Michael Heseltine, that he was close to contempt of court. Some miners say that while the uncertainty continues, their pits are getting more and more run down.